thank each and every one for being here at One Accord Church this morning. We are glad you're here, and we are glad people edit this. Amen. But if you're, viewing us live, you may be on our website this morning, which is oneaccordchurch.net, and you might even be streaming us live, but we want to thank you for tuning in through our website and streaming. I also want to tell you, you can go to our website and leave us messages, prayer request needs, and whatever those needs are, we will be more than glad to contact you. Also, thank you for those on our television programs. We appreciate you listening as well. And I always want to take the time to invite you to come join us at One Accord Church. We simply believe in the Bible. That's it. It don't need no further explanation. If it's in here, we stand on it. If it's not, we don't. Amen?
Amen.
And we just want you to come join us on this Palm Sunday. You know, a lot of times people don't know what Palm Sunday really is. In fact, it's one of the greatest messages of what took place before Easter. And so many things took place that we really could learn from if we would really listen to the Word of God. This message today is entitled, The Colt, The Crowd, and The Children. Because there was three different things that was taught on this Palm Sunday. You know, and as my wife is back there and those with the children, she found some little palm branches and stuff that she's going to be telling them about this. Because this was Jesus' entrance as he was approaching Jerusalem. This is, Jesus and his disciples are going to Jerusalem. And as they're going in, this marks, as Jesus enters in, the beginning of the end of the old and the beginning of the new. Yeah. And there's so much that took place that when we do Palm Sunday, we leave out a very strong part of what this message is really about. You know, why the beginning and the end? Well, it's the beginning of the trials and the crucifixion of Christ. That was what laid ahead. Also, then would come the resurrection, which is the birth of the church. And this is taking place. This is why Palm Sunday is so important. I want us to set the scene this morning. Thousands of people were gathered in Jerusalem for the Passover. Now, at this Passover, here we're going to go into the book of Matthew, chapter 21, and we want to read the story of how this triumphant entry of Jerusalem that Jesus took and what took place when he came into this city. I want you to take your Bibles and turn with me, if you will, to Matthew chapter 21 and go into verse 1, if you will. And let's follow along, church, because this story is so important because it reaches so much that's going on in this world today that we really need to open our eyes to. Yes, I believe with all my heart, you know, I was looking out and thinking about the church and what the church has been through. You know, God will sustain his church, but God will not sustain our church. We need to get back to where Jesus was when he traveled into this city. I want you to listen to God's word in Matthew 21. Look at verse 1 in the beginning. And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, Go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto you, ye shall say, The Lord hath need of them, and straightway he will send them. And all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Tell ye the daughter of Zion, Behold, the king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass and a colt, and the colt, the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this? And the multitude said, This is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of the sold doves, and said unto them, It is written, My house shall be called the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. And when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were sore displeased and said unto him, Hearest thou what these say? And Jesus said unto them, Yea, have you never read? Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings thou hast perfected praise? Jesus cleans out the church. All of a sudden the children's ready to have church. And all the people that thought they knew everything didn't like it. I want us to break this message down this morning because we need to understand some concepts about what the book of Matthew talked about. We have a colt, we have a crowd, and we have the children. Now, how does this tie in to what today's day and time? Well, first of all, the disciples was to go bring the colt to Jesus. The crowd was there praises and giving praise. There was a lot of people there praising, right? The children. But of all things, the children were wiser than anybody in this crowd. You know, it really tears my heart up to see when we think about Palm Sunday, what Jesus had to see. Do you know the only ones that, when the temple was cleaned out, the ones that wanted to praise, the people wanted to shut up? Why are our children the way they are? Because everybody that had a religious degree decided that they didn't need to be heard. You know, I thought about this as I was doing our announcements and looking at it. I thought about a question. I want you to think about this question. Everybody listening, how many young people are desiring to go into the ministry? We've shut them up. We've lost them. Well, no, I haven't. Where are they? Jesus looked at a multitude that was throwing their clothes out and throwing everything out and getting palm branches. But Jesus knew that when it come time that they would depart. Jesus knew what would happen. But we're going to listen to this, and we're going to listen to what God's word says, and we are going to open the door about some things. We read it in Matthew 21, verses 2 through 7, about the colt. Jesus gave his disciples a strange instruction. Now, everybody don't never really relate this, and I want us to see inside. Everybody still with me? Good. Jesus gave his disciples something, a strange instruction. Go tell the guy in the village, when you find a colt tied in the ass, okay, both of them, they were to loose the unbroken colt and the unbroken ass and bring it to Jesus. Anybody ever gone to try to get an unbroken donkey and bring him somewhere? Now, anybody that's dealt with horses, if something's unbroken, there's a reason they call him unbroke. But I want you to know, you said, what's that got to do with something? Jesus had a message in his every single word that he ever spoke, if we would look into it. The answer to their question was this. Think about it. The Lord needed them. The Lord sent them to get them. And what are we supposed to bring from this? Listen very closely, church that claims to be the church. We are to bring Jesus, those with an unbroken will. How many of you come to Jesus because you were so good you just finally decided to get saved? I'm just going to come. I mean, I'm doing everything right to start with. I might as well just go ahead and get it all done. Can you say unbroken will? Now you say, what's that? Okay, I know. Let's get it straight. Hard-headed, stubborn, mule-headed, trying to do it your way until you meet Jesus. But I want to relate to you this. Listen, yes, we would love for everybody just to come as, you know, the way we want you. Come to church and hear that. You want to come to church? Let me buy you some church clothes. Come on, you're still awake, so work with me. Say, yeah, we want to fix them up so they'll look like the church. Yeah. Wrong. The church is supposed to be the people that are broken that can come in. The church is not a retirement home. The church is a recovery for those that are broken and need Jesus. We don't understand this. You know, the reason he said, look, go get me. I'm pretty sure the disciples thought, now listen, you're sending us to get a coat and an ass that's not broken, and you want us to bring them to you. Now, I'm pretty sure they're going to have a fit when we try to drag them jokers to where we want to go. But that just proves to you something. Jesus says, bring them unto me. Bring them. Don't worry about getting a haircut. Don't worry about finding them some pretty shoes to put on. Listen, I'm not worried about what they look like. I want you to bring them to me so that I can give them eternal life, so I can touch their soul. See, let me tell you something. You can fix all this up all you want to, but if you're still broken inside, you're still a train wreck. Jesus came here to set us free, not from this, but from the heart, what was going on inside. Jesus told him to do this, and listen, he said, that stubborn will of that unbroken coat, guess what he did? Did Jesus have to say, listen, anybody here that can train a coat? Because I got to get on him. Now, I got to be the first one to ride this colt. I got to be the first one to get on. So anybody, carry him down there to the ranch and break him so that I can ride him. Did he do that?
No.
Somebody stay with me. What did he do? He got on him.
Yeah.
And guess what that colt did? Nothing. No matter what he might have been thinking, when Jesus showed up, he overcome everything that donkey was even thinking about doing. And I'm pretty sure them disciples was probably going to, I'm paraphrasing, don't look in your Bible, that ain't there. Jesus, you do know they're not broken. Jesus, I'm paraphrasing, don't look in your Bible. Jesus probably looked at them and said, so were you. Before I showed up. Now, I'm just going to come. This ain't in the Bible. So, if I can get a stubborn mule, stubborn human being, I probably have better success with it in the mule than I do people. Let's just be honest. See, y'all ain't liking this too good, are you? I thought he just went to get something just to go get something. No, Jesus had a reason for everything he did. You know, the submission of the colt is a picture of the coming kingdom of Christ. Look, when Jesus shows up, we're going to submit. When Jesus returns, let me give you a news flash. You might be that person that's decided you're not going to do it now, but you will submit to Christ. You will submit. You will come under the authority, whether you like it or not. The good news of it is we have a free will that we can choose to do it now. So we know that the colt was brought before the disciples, and we understand that the message base is real simple there. Hey, it doesn't matter. Whatever I speak happens. But listen, because when Christ comes, now, you say, why did he pick a colt? Why didn't he pick a camel? Better yet, why didn't he just tell them to send a chariot with some wheels on it? Come on. Yeah, why didn't he do anything of this? Because let me tell you something. I love this scripture. In your Bibles, you go to Revelation 19:11, and I want you to understand something. Now, Jesus might have jumped on a colt. And some people don't like to use the word ass because we as human beings have turned that into a bad word. Okay. But regardless of whether you say colt or ass, it's in the Bible. But what my point of it is, Jesus might have rode in Jerusalem to knowing what he was going to be facing on a lonely old colt. Something that nobody had no respect for other than using them to tote supplies and carry supplies and want the prettiest thing in the world to start with. But let me tell you what, Jesus made her come in Jerusalem lowly, humbly. But let me tell you what's going to happen the next thing he rides in on. All right, everybody still with me? In Revelation 19:11, look what he's going to ride in on next. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doeth judge and make war. His eyes were as flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed upon him with white horses, clothed in fine linen with white and clean, and out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepresses of fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on him his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Palm Sunday might be Jesus coming in at the lowly. But let me tell you something. When he comes back, that white horse, it's going to show us, hey, I came here the first time so I could humble myself before you and give you every opportunity in the world to follow me. But when I come back the next time, let me go on and tell you something. When I come back this time with my armies, anybody here know how to ride a horse? Well, you're going to get trained. And it ain't going to be no donkey or no colt or no ass. It's going to be a white horse. So let me tell you something. Jesus picked the way he entered into Jerusalem because it was prophesied what he would do. And Jesus carried out that purpose. Also on Palm Sunday, there was a crowd that we need to mention. You know, there's always a crowd around. Anybody ever notice that? Let something go wrong, you got a crowd. Let something new come up that nobody ain't seen, you got a crowd. Yeah. Well, it's no different. Verse 8, we just read in Matthew 21, said the multitude spread their garments before Jesus. Now picture this. How many of you got on your good clothes? How many of you would take them off and throw them down at the feet of Jesus? Are you kidding? We get mad if somebody at the restaurant spills something on it. Everybody was, okay, here he comes. Boy, they were pulling off their stuff and throwing them at his feet. Yeah. Not only that, then they placed palm branches, which gives us Palm Sunday, along the way. And they were throwing down these palm branches. And what was the crowd doing? Praising. Yeah. Shouting. Here he comes. Here he comes. Excited. Anybody excited? Please let me see you're excited. We should be excited. Listen. They said, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna to the highest. Boy, they were just praising him. Excited. Well, y'all better get practiced up. Because see, when he shows up this time, when he breaks that sky, if you ain't shouting good, you're going to be shouting really bad. You'll be going, praise, glory to God. Uh-oh. I don't know about you, but I want to get in the habit of praise. Amen. Why do you think Jesus was telling them? He said, listen, they were praising him. Yeah, all the people was praising him. But notice something. Have you ever noticed how a crowd can change? Yeah. If you don't believe me, go on your media. Say a bunch of good things. And then one bad thing happened. Yeah. Are you kidding? Y'all want a book written or a movie, just do something stupid. And the whole world stops and take note. What people are doing is praising the world, praising the circumstance. But notice this crowd with the praise. Oh, here he comes. Here he comes. Shouting till they lose their breath. Then all of a sudden, they're going to be the same ones that turn on him. Instead of going, praise the Lord, they're going to be rude, hateful, taunting, mocking, and cursing. This same crowd that claimed to love him turned on him. Soon, all these blessings became booze. All of a sudden, it's like they were. Anybody ever seen a game? Well, people are shouting because someone made a shot. They like to break the breachers down, screaming and shouting, and then they miss one. All of a sudden, he went from there to there. Yeah. Get him out of the game. He made 100 points, but he missed one. That's people. That's what they did to Jesus. all of a sudden, this crowd, crown him King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Instead of crowning him, they were ready to crucify him. Palm Sunday was not the entrance of just a man. It was the entrance of our salvation. It was the entrance of their salvation. And they knew it. And they still turned on him. Let me say that to you again. They knew it, but they still turned on him. The church knows Jesus is coming back, but they're still turning on him. Listen, folks, we better quit turning, because you might be caught in that turn when he comes. We need to understand Palm Sunday. Yes, Jesus is going in Jerusalem. Yes, Jesus is going to go to the cross. Jesus knew why he was going. He knew that these people that was praising him, thousands of people was like, yeah. He knew they'd be the very ones that turned on him. What have we done? Easter's coming. It's a celebration about what he did. Are we that crowd that praises him when it's good, but backs out when it's bad? No, not us. Really? Where's our commitment? Where's our commitment to our young people? Where's our faith? Not hearing much. This crowd is on fire for him. But now, the newness is wore off. Anybody saved? Don't raise your head. How dare you put me on the spot? Anybody remember how you felt? Of course, y'all weren't as bad as sinners as I am. So y'all didn't feel what I felt. Let me go on and tell you something. I couldn't do nothing but cry. Yeah. Because of what all of a sudden I was given. Yeah. That's the way the crowd was when they met Jesus. He's here. Yeah. Then 2 weeks later, no, forget 2 weeks. A few days later, crucify him. Yeah. Well, Pastor, we're not that bad. When you signed up with Jesus, you signed up with the Word. Amen. Not what the preacher says, but the Word. Don't leave mad at me. Get mad at yourself for not allowing yourself to still praise God through His Word. Jesus, I read to you in Revelation, says, and the Word of God. Is that what it's saying? Yeah. And listen, I praised Him because I read the Word. Because somebody told me about Jesus in the Word, I met Jesus. I met the Word. We all met the Word at one time in our life that give us salvation. He says, believe it and receive it. The Word all of a sudden became real. The Word became true. The Word became what I needed to feel alive again. The Word is what we took inside of us so that we knew, hey, there's hope. This crown was on fire for Jesus. But there were some people in charge. I'm going to call them the demon deacon crowd. We got good deacons, though. I'm not putting ours down. But they decided that they were going to say, well, Jesus done went in the church. Who does he think he is? Here he is, comes in here on some donkey. And the first thing he does is go in our temple and starts throwing out our folks. How dare he? He ain't even a member, for crying out loud. He didn't even wash his hands or his feet before he went in there, for crying out loud. And what is he? Who does he think he is? Throwing all our people out that's making money. How do you think we're keeping this building going? Walks in there and throws them all. Then he has the audacity to flip over our little thing we got for our sacrifices and our money changing tables. The reason why Jesus, and this is what the Lord said to me, the reason why Jesus went in there and throwed everything out, because what was in there wasn't Jesus.
Amen.
And why he throwed everything out was because, notice what he did when he throwed it all out. He started healing.
Yeah. Yeah.
So apparently they were already there.
Yeah. Yeah.
They didn't get on the smartphones and say, hey boys, go to the temple. Jesus just throwed everybody out. I think we're going to have a healing service.
Thank you, Lord.
No, they were standing there watching.
Yes, Lord.
When Jesus got the mess out, he brought in Jesus. And when he brought them in, all of a sudden he said, now, it's time to have church.
Glory.
See, Palm Sunday was just his entrance to go to the cross. But before he went to the cross, he went to the church.
Yes,
said, look, I'm going to clean you out. I'm going to show you what's going to the cross. What's going to the cross is getting rid of the fake church. Get rid of the mess that you've put in here that don't belong in there. And I'm going to start off by having a healing service. I know that ain't in your Baptist handbook, but we're going to have a healing service right now. I don't want you to vote me in as your preacher. I am the church, and I've come to set the church free. And I'm going to start by healing all these folks that have been standing at your door that you're not letting in. That's Palm Sunday. Oh, he won't finish. Jesus was just getting started. He knew where he was going. He knew what was ahead of him. But I want you to, let's look at something, folks. Look at the children. This is why I told him, I said, our children really need to understand this. All you listening, our children, in verses 12 through 16, it said that in the cleansing of the temple, once the temple was clean, Jesus was healing everybody, the blind and the lame, and then also the anger of the Lord's enemies. Look what they said in verse 16. I got to read it to you again in Matthew 21. He said this, and said unto him, hearest thou what these say? Now this was the church people. Jesus said unto them, yea, now please take note what he says. Take note what he says to the children, about the children. Ye, hey, have you never read? Now why did Jesus say that? Anybody know? I'll tell you why. Because it was prophesied. Go to Psalms 8:2. Jesus said it for a reason. You claim to know the word. You claim to be all religious. You claim to know everything. Well, why didn't you know this?
Yeah.
See, they were messing up when they tried to question Jesus. Because he is the word.
Yes,
and in Psalms 8:2, look what it was prophesied. Notice what Jesus said. Now look at Psalms 8:2. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies, that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. Now, go back to 16 in Matthew 21. Look what he said. Jesus said unto him, yea, have you never read? Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings thou hast perfected praise. See, these dummies in this religious group questioned Jesus. Why? Because who was praising? The children. He says, hold it right there, all you religious people that messed up the church. All you people that wrote all them laws and bylaws and ordained laws, all them laws that I come to set you free from. Go back in remembrance to the Old Testament, what was said. Now, I'm going to repeat exactly what was said because I am the Word. Now, how can you stop what these children are doing? That's what they're here to do. When we praise the Lord, I looked at our young people. Do you know what most of them did? Not much. Well, it's the generation. No, it's not. It's the lack of knowledge of what we're supposed to have shared. Palm Sunday, the children was praising. So much that the religious people said, what? Do you see what they're doing? Hey, Jesus, what do you think you're doing? Hearest thou what these say? Jesus was nicer than I would have been. I said, well, at least somebody's willing to praise him. Yeah. Our young people have got to get some praise back in them, and they're not going to get it unless we put down the things that are destroying the church and let them know this is what's pleasing to God. He said it. Jesus said it. He says, and it's pleasing. He said, thou hast perfected praise. Our young people have perfected praise. They've perfected praise. How many of you would love to see young kids praising God? What's happened? Jesus saw the same thing. No, the children didn't deny Christ a few days later, but the leadership did. The leadership put him on the cross. The leadership went against him. But Jesus, before he went to the cross, he'd done something so important on Palm Sunday. He cleaned up the church.
Amen.
He throwed them all out. Then when they got thrown out, they got mad. You mean to tell me you're going to let them children come to church and praise God? What's wrong with you? Jesus said, it's written. We want God back in church. We won't see the presence of God in the church. We have got to get our young people back where they need to be, because that's what God ordained. Our young people should be the ones ushering us in a praise, instead of terrified because of not what they know, but what they've seen. Come on. I'm not here to beat you down. Let me tell you something. God didn't put me here to beat nobody down. God put me here to tell you it's time to wake up. Come on. I was raised in it. If you raised your hand in church, somebody slapped it down. And you better be seen and not heard. If you do, you're going to get slapped anyway. I thought people that raised a hand was those that's trying to make up for everything they did wrong the other 6 days of the week. And it was probably right. We come in on Sunday and praise him. Then on Monday we go out and, oh well. And we wonder, what happened? You ever wonder what's going to happen to the church? Well, Jesus came and said, I done cleaned out the church. I got rid of this mess. I brought the power of healing back in it. I better yet, I even brought your children in and showed y'all how to do it. Now, what have we done through generations? Let me tell you what we've done. We've gotten rid of everything that Jesus set up that day. Our young people say, I don't want to go into the service today because I find church boring. Let's find something fun to do. Can you imagine what it does to Jesus' heart? Notice Jesus didn't make the youngins leave. He got rid of the adults. All right, y'all going to sit here and go to sleep like a bump on a pickle. Okay, I'll find somebody that's going to come in here and praise. I'm going to get rid of y'all, and I'm going to get something in here. But what have we done? We've taken them out. Palm Sunday is all about Jesus not going just to the cross, but going to the church and reestablishing the church so that it would healing took place. And that's why it's so important for us not to forget reaching our children. Because, we're coming up on in this ministry here 10 years. And I'll never forget the words that first time me and Graham ever met. He called me. Of course, I had just been. I said, I ain't going back to that place. I ain't going to tell you what I said. I said, hell will freeze over. Before I walk back in that door. Graham said, you got to know Graham. Well, Pastor, if you don't come out here, we're done. I got off the phone and felt about that big. I said, news forecast. Hell's about to freeze over. But then I realized that Jesus is telling us, who's going to step in? Where is our future, our leadership? I know we don't like it. It's okay. But listen, when we get to heaven, we're going to be praising the Lord. I would have given anything in my life to have sat down with my mom and daddy in church and see them so full of Jesus that when I wanted to be like my daddy. Come on, church. I might have been a little kid, but if my daddy would have been praising the Lord, I'd have jumped up and praised it with him. And he'd have been proud of me. See, we've been trained and ordained and we've did everything that we've lost. The purpose of why Jesus came. Get excited. It won't kill you. If it does, we'll bury you. Free of charge. But how are we going to get anybody else excited unless we get excited? Well, I don't like what you said, preacher. Get over it. Because Jesus wants us to get excited. I can see us when he splits the sky. Oh, it's you. Let me go on and tell you something. If you're in my way, I'm going to knock you out of the way. I'm going to be going, I'm ready. But until I get there, why not get ready now? Why not let's bring back a generation that drugs and alcohol, suicide and all this mess that's taking the lives of our kids. We got the opportunity and authority in the name of Jesus to get rid of that mess because Jesus cast it out and we should keep it out and bring in Jesus. That's what Palm Sunday means to me. Church, out of the mouth of babes, in little babies, hast thou ordained with strength. Can you think about it? Somebody, think about it. What would happen? What would happen if our young people got on fire for Jesus? Travis, go get our young people. What would happen if all of a sudden we felt Jesus in our children? Well, Pastor, it's too late. Listen, it might be too late in your book, but if Jesus can sit on a wild colt and ride him into Jerusalem, Jesus can handle our youth.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Well, I don't know what to do with them. Listen, give them to Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
I don't know how we're going to get this colt to Jesus. He's going to kill us. It don't matter. Jesus ordained it. Go do it. Jesus will take care of the rest.
Yes.
Our life in the ministries depend on us ushering in Jesus like they did in Jerusalem. Palm Sunday is not about just going to the cross. Palm Sunday was about Jesus going in Jerusalem, this religious place, and not only going there, but going right straight to the temple and cleaning out the church and bringing in the power of God back in it.
Yes,
that's what's missing.
Glory,
I know because I've been just like everybody. Well, it's out of our hands. Do we really want Jesus to show up and clean out the church? We're here. We're here in this church. Every one of you, look at me. We are here.
Yes, Lord.
We are here. And our children are here. Jesus said, I've ordained my young people. I've ordained them to praise. I've ordained them. Look, Palm Sunday, Jesus recognized our young people. Why? Why would he do something like that? Is he like embarrassing young people?
No.
They were the only ones that actually experienced the presence of Jesus.
Amen.
They actually are the ones that felt him, and Jesus felt them. Our young people are our future. You know, I thought about this today. I said, Lord, who's going to take my place if something happens to me? You know what the devil said? Nobody. Because I'm going to shut down the church. That's my job. How am I going to do that? Shut down my youth. How am I going to do that? Shut down the parents. Don't get mad at me. My granddaughter, her life is over. She's in jail. Can't change that. But we sure can change what we got in front of us. Our children can see us real. How important is it for us to be real? Well, you're asking somebody that knows. If we don't get real, it's going to get too late.
Yeah.
I love these kids. I just want them to love Jesus.
Amen.
I want to see what Jesus saw when he went in that temple. When he throwed out all these people. Praise glory to God. He chunked them all out. But then they stood outside going, "What are you doing? You got rid of everything. Now, on top of that, now you're going to heal everybody? What you thinking, Jesus?" And during the whole time, guess what the young people were doing? They were praising him. They were praising him because, look, they didn't know no better. Uh-oh. They didn't know no better. That you know, let me tell you something. We were better Christians when we didn't know no better. We were more excited when we didn't know no better. We were more excited when we got baptized because we didn't know no better. Now we know better. And look at us. What has happened? You said, "I'll be glad when this message is over with." No, you better hope it don't never end. Because if you do, we lose. See, I want to tell you a surprise. I don't care if you live to be 100. It's just a very short space of time of eternity. Newsflash, God didn't put us here to succeed in the world. He put us here to succeed in Him. Every single one of you in this room, God ain't gonna care about your job in the world. He's gonna care about your job in the ministry. Our young people deserve to have the opportunity to grow in the ministry. Some of you young people in here right now, they know Scripture. Joan has told me that some of them know Scripture better than she does. But we've messed up. Well, it's time. Jesus is going into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. Let's quit throwing things before Him and then walking away. Let's put our children before Him. And let's put ourselves before Him. I don't want Jesus to come clean out another church. I've witnessed Him cleaning out a church. And it ain't beneath Him to do it. But if He has to get His children back, He'll do it. Every one of us in this room need to ask ourselves a question. Are we a part of the crowd that's just going to look? Or are we going to be a part of the crowd that's going to do? I know that CJ, I'm not going to pick on him, but ever since he's a little feller, he always watched us. Even when he would say, "Look, Mama, there he is on television." I remember every one of these kids when they were little things. So here's what I want you to do. I want to open this altar up. Are we going to be that church that's going to thank Jesus that He stepped in? Are we going to be the church that's going to say, "Thank you, Lord, that you stepped in and got rid of Satan and brought you back"? Are we going to be the church that's going to accept your healing? Are we going to be that church that's going to accept your promise for your children? I don't want to see no more children go where my granddaughter is gone. I don't want to see it happen again. I can't fix her, but Jesus can. Is He going to fix us? Are we going to be fixable today? I'm going to open this altar up.